If you'd asked me 5 years ago, Robert, where will you be 5 years from now? I don't think I would have been able to come up with an answer as cool as what I actually feel like I'm doing, you know? Alexander, and I'm a data sonification specialist with the Sorority Helios Friedrich Research Group. To sonify something just means that you're taking any type of data and just turning it into sound. So it could be a measurement of, you know, the stock market. It could be a measurement of people entering and exiting a room. It could be your heartbeat. So if you think about a heart rate monitor, you know, beep, beep, essentially, this is a sonification of someone's pulse. I think of myself as an explorer. I live in the space between art and science and technology. And the Toroidal Universe project is a great example. I collaborated with this amazing visual artist by the name of Danielle Battaglia, and we created this multi-sensory experience in which people could just get lost in these theoretical, higher dimensional spaces. And these were filled with these sounds that I generated from raw satellite data. There were these kind of guideposts as you move around. It really is important for me to remain sort of grounded in what it means to just be connected with the world of sound, you know, in a very tangible, a very visceral way. So then when I go off and I'm, you know, interacting with the sun, you know, it gives me a sense of grounding in a sense, and it kind of like helps to just round out my life and to maintain a healthy sort of balance, I guess you could say. So as I was finishing up my master's degree, I was approached by Thomas Zubrucken, who leads the Solar Heliospheric Research Group. And he was interested in taking some of their data and turning it into sound. So I met with their team, and they put up a bunch of plots, and they were telling me about coronal holes, and they were throwing out the scientific jargon, and I really didn't understand much of it, but then they put up these images and these movies. Started to understand why they were so excited is because, you know, like, what's happening out there is absolutely amazing, and it was all silent. So essentially they're interested in kind of like creating a soundtrack for these things that are taking place out in space.
He brought to us this, you know, this idea of sonifying data, which is really, you know, quite innovative and maybe even transformative.
I had no idea what data audification was, but that's what I was doing at the time. Is I was taking this solar data and I was writing it directly to audio files. So I hit play and, you know, I hear this underlying hum. And there seemed to be a structure, like the hum would sort of rise and fall. So then after I crunched all the numbers, I realized that what I was listening to was something that was periodically happening every roughly 27 days. And that's exactly the rotational period of the sun. And then, you know, from there it was this journey of realizing that, like, I'm listening to the solar cycle, so the rise and the fall in solar activity. And then, you know, at that point I realized, like, this can really actually teach us something new. At first, it came off as, you know, extremely sort of cerebral, and it was just a tone that kind of went up and down, and there really wasn't very much sort of emotion behind it, and we really didn't know how we wanted to start to investigate these sounds. So then as it evolved, they said, well, how about we try an emotional journey? So, you know, a week later, I came back and I'd created this iteration whereby you take a journey from the Earth out to the sun and back with sonification audio kind of underlying this whole entire experience. Every single piece of that music is driven in some way, shape, or form by that data. And all of the choices in terms of the rise and the fall, all of them relate back to the underlying data, and all of them are true to the data in some way, shape, or form. Starting with one of the more predominant things that you're actually hearing is that drum beat. And there's a question of, you know, are there African tribal drummers on the surface of the sun? And the answer is no. But if you think about a scientific graph, there are hash marks, and you need these sort of hash marks to make sense. So what the drum beat is, it's a sort of grandiose metronome in a sense, and it just lets you know where you are within this data set. So for that piece with the drumming, that's all over the year 2003. And the drumming actually lets you know, like every 8 bars, that you've gone through one full rotation of the sun. And in a sense, if you hear something that happens at the beginning of a bar, and then you hear something happen again, similarly at the beginning, like, you know, 8 bars later, then you know that this might be like a feature that's persisted across an entire solar rotation now, and it's coming back in the musical form. And the sun then provides the structure and can provide these sort of recurring themes, and the drums just kind of give it that structure within which to evolve. I recorded the voice of my sister Amanda Alexander, and she has a great alto voice. And you know, originally I was thinking about these charge states of carbon and the fact that as one of them goes up, another one comes down. And so when you have like a lower voice or versus a higher voice, there's actually more energy sort of pushing out those higher notes. So when I'm representing a higher energetic state, I'm using a more energized voice. And in this way, it's kind of appealing directly to the intuition of the listener in that, you know, when you hear these voices get more energized, you're at a sort of higher energy level coming from the sun, essentially. I create a structure, I create a framework, and without the data driving that framework, nothing takes place. So the structure just kind of exists on its own, and then it's the data that creates all the motion, that creates all the interaction and all the progression of the music.
Initially, it started out sort of more looking at sort of the aesthetics of how can you sonify solar wind, you know, just make, you know, and with a musical sort of approach. But then it sort of evolved more into a scientific data analysis method. When he was working with the scientists here, Enrico Landi, who was, I believe, the first author on the paper, he found that he could actually hear some of the trends more clearly in some of the elements.
I was digging through, you know, like 20, 30 different data parameters and listening to them all. And I realized that if I listened to carbon, that I could hear a very strong harmonic presence. And I started to think, you know, if I'm hearing carbon here, but no one in the group has ever really been talking about carbon, it's not really something you know, that they stress as being important. And yet here, like fundamentally, this is one of like the strongest sort of periodic signals that I'd found up to that point. I'm thinking, you know, maybe this is something worth looking into a little bit more. We were able to figure out that if we use carbon, that we can trace the origins of the solar wind with a higher accuracy, so we can figure out where it's originating on the sun.
This was, you know, fairly significant research findings that came out of this modification thing. So it really, I think, kind of set the stage for Robert to do a lot more exciting things with the sonification of data.
We wrote everything up, and we said that the ear can be an extremely powerful tool in the analysis of this type of data, of time series data. And some people in NASA, I guess, got excited about that, and they said, all right, let's give it a shot. And so now I'm in the second year of my NASA JPFP fellowship, and I spent the last summer working at NASA Goddard, and I was really amazed at how eager they all were to pick up the ball with sonification. And so it was just really invigorating to be in that kind of space with those kinds of minds and to be tackling these kinds of ideas. We forget that the most powerful tool that we have for exploring the universe is right between our two ears. And those same two ears provide a wealth of information beyond what our eyes can actually see. when we open up our ears and, you know, open up our minds, we open ourselves up to an entirely new way of understanding the universe.